Important to know, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was empty, without form, but the Spirit of God hovered upon the face of the waters. And then God said, so you cannot separate the Spirit from the Word. You cannot separate the Word from the Spirit. So we got to trust God for supernatural moves of the Holy Spirit. And in the same time, we must trust God to get in the Word and get fresh revelation knowledge. Without vision, people perish. The word vision in the Bible in Proverbs is without revelation. And if you go into it without fresh revelation, okay? So we believe we live in continuous revelation of the Word of God. So what worked in 46 might have been good for 46, but we are in 2013, and we need to hear, what is God saying right now? What is the Spirit saying right now? There was a great preacher by the name of F.B. Myers. I read all his books. He lived in the 30s, and just before his death, he spoke to a lot of pastors, 4,000 preachers, and he stood up after over 60 years of ministry, and this is what he said: after 60 years of ministry, I have so much to say. But what does God want to say right now? This is what is important. If I just have a few messages that I preach and preach and preach and preach, it may not be anymore what God has been, what God is saying. It might be what God has said last year, November. But what God, what is God saying right now on this 13th day of the 12th month, no, the second month of the year 2013. 13213 is an easy number to remember, okay? Of the year of our Lord Jesus Christ. What is God saying to the church right now? And I believe God really wants to speak to us about his love, you know? And the love of God, like I said earlier on in the worship, the love of God has been shared abroad in our hearts by the Holy Spirit, which has been given to us. So if I truly live in a constant filling of the Holy Spirit, Ephesians 5:18, be ye filled, be being filled, says the Amplified. So I must constantly be filled with the Holy Ghost. And if I'm constantly filled, God is love. Okay? But God is Spirit. So if I'm filled with the Spirit, I'm filled with God. If I'm filled with God, I'm filled with love. For God is love. And he that loveth knoweth God. He that loveth not knoweth not God. For God is love. Okay? So the more I know God, the more I love the Spirit. The more I have the Spirit, the more I will be filled with the love of the Almighty God. God is love. And tonight, maybe we're going to be here for an hour or two around the Word and trust God for some supernatural outpourings of the Holy Spirit. Tomorrow morning, we're going to have the pool meeting, and we're going to go through the pool. Prophet Hubert's going to minister tomorrow evening. He loves to minister in the evening. I didn't know, so I found it out this morning. So I said, let's change meetings. I love to have the pool in the morning, you know. So then we can go home and get dressed and, you know, be ready for the evening service. And we trust God for supernatural stuff at the pool. We have prepared 3,000 prayer cloths. We've anointed it, different prophets from across the world prayed over those cloths. We've anointed it with different preachers there, and we kept it. And Friday night, we've cut it up in little pieces. And tomorrow morning, we're going to give you each a prayer cloth. So it's not a cloak that you have to wear around. It's something that you can put in your wallet. There's some offerings left behind you. One there. And one year. God spoke to me one day. He says, when you honor the 10 cents that somebody can give, I will trust you with the millions that somebody else can give. I don't know what happened to my glasses. Is it somewhere around? It was somewhere around. Fritz, come bless us, brother. Come. Bless you, brother. Right? There was going to be a play of the school, but I think the time... Forgive us. Time dragged. Who's ready for the Word? Okay, relax. I think that was the word this morning. Relax. Okay? I know how to drive this thing. Relax. The other stuff is fine. Relax. Hebrews chapter 1. Let's do. I think we should do Hebrews tonight. Okay, now remember, God so loved the world. We can all quote it. That he gave. Help me. God so loved the world, what? That what? That what must happen? Help me. That whosoever should not, but is it true? Your Bible says the same thing. Okay, so there's mics in the front for you to help me preach. God so loved. What did he do? He gave. His only son. Okay. So as Moses lifted up the serpent in the desert, we did it yesterday morning, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, so that all who believe in him should not perish but have everlasting life. So God so loved the world. Where did he prove it? On the cross of Christ. God so loved the world that he gave his, so that whosoever believe in him. How much life? How long would everlasting be? So if you die, what happened to you? What happened to your body? It perishes. Why did Jesus come? That you should not perish. But Kubas, that's spiritual. Okay, 1 Thessalonians 5 verse 23 says, I pray that your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved until the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. What must be preserved? Your whole spirit, your whole soul, and your whole body must be preserved till the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. 1 Corinthians 15, the first man was of the earth, earthy, a natural man. The second man is the Lord from heaven. As we have borne the image of the earthy, so we shall also bear the image of the heavenly. For this corruption must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. The law enemy to be conquered is just as an introduction. I never even thought of it for this night. But if somebody died, he did not conquer death. Death conquered him. So if we stand at a funeral and we say, here is Uncle Jack going down. At last he conquered death. No, he didn't. He's dead. One plus one equals? Is it in Russia? Where's the Russians? Where's the Russians? Is it the same in Russia? America? Holland? Where's Holland? Huh? Okay, one and one is two. Okay, so if somebody died, death conquered him. He did not conquer death. So God so loved the world that he gave. If we have a love conference, and the greatest is love, herein is love, not that we love God, but that God loved us. Greater love has no one that one would lay down his life for his friends. So what did Jesus do? He laid down his life for his friends. With all that in mind, Hebrews chapter 1. That wasn't part of the message, so you can deduct it from your offering at the end of the meeting. Right. Verse 2 says, in the last of these days, God has spoken to us in the person of his Son, whom he appointed heir and lawful owner of all things. Look this way. Do you think Jesus Christ is truly heir of the throne?
Yes.
Is he lawful heir and owner of all things?
Yes.
The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. It's his earth.
Yes.
It's not the devil's earth. Oh, Quibus, but the devil is the god of this world. Who said so? Yeah, but 2 Corinthians says in chapter 4, the god of this world has blinded the eyes. He explains who the god of the world is that blinded the eyes. Jesus says, you have eyes but cannot see. And he tells us exactly who it is. He says in Hebrews chapter 9, they had a tabernacle, but one of this world. And he says, while this tabernacle is a recognized institution, that means the temple in Jerusalem, the temple, tabernacle, store of story. As long as it's a recognized institution, the way into the true Holy of Holies is not yet thrown open. But the Holy Spirit speaks explicitly that Jesus died and went into the true tabernacle, not with the blood of bulls and goats, but with his own blood to bring for us an eternal salvation. So the God of this world that blinds the eyes of believers is the law. As long as you read the law, 2 Corinthians tells us in chapter 3, there's a veil over your face and you cannot see. But when you turn to the Lord, which is the Spirit, the veil shall be removed, and we all with open face as in a mirror beholding the face of Jesus Christ, we are changed from the glory of the old which Moses saw to the glory of the new, which is the very image of the Son of God himself. As we have bore the image of the earthy, we shall also bear the image of the heavenly. Heir and lawful, that was heir. Heir and lawful owner of all things. But I do think Galatians 4 says, as long as the heir is a child, he differs nothing from a slave, but is under tutors and governors till the time appointed of the father. But when the fullness of time came, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, made under the law, to redeem those that were under the law, that we can receive the adoption of sons. And now that we have the spirit of the son, he cries, Abba Father. That makes us heirs of God and joint heirs with Jesus Christ. If he is then heir and owner of the world, and I'm a joint heir, then I am heir and owner of this world. It means this world belongs to us, and we need to take our authority. Oh God, our God, how excellent is your name in all the earth. Out of the mouth of babes and sucklings thou hast prepared praise for thee. If I behold the moon and the stars, what is man that thou art mindful of him, and the son of man that you visit him? You crown him with glory and honor and set him over the work of your hands to rule and have dominion. Hebrews chapter 1. Let's read some scriptures before I preach. Through whom he created the worlds and the reaches of space and the ages of time, he made, produced, built, operated, and arranged them in order. Now listen to verse 3. He is the sole expression. There's a little bit of feedback on the stage, bass feedback, sorry. He is the sole expression of the glory of God. Hey, just stop. Just look at this minute. Sorry if I need to say it. Jesus is the sole expression of the glory of God, the outraying of the radiance, of the brilliance, of the divine, the express image of God the Father. If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. Show us the Father, and it'll suffice for us. If you've seen me, Philip, how long have I been you? Have you not seen me? If you've seen me, you have seen the Father. Now, Jesus Christ is the sole expression of the glory of God. If Jesus Christ is the sole expression, how come we are taught that Adam lost the glory? There is no scripture in the Bible that said Adam had glory. No scripture. Oh, but Adam lost the glory. Where did you read that? Romans 3:23, Quibus. No, what does Romans 23 say? 3:23. It says, all have sinned and come short of the glory. It doesn't say they missed the glory, they lost the glory, they haven't. It says they still come short of the glory because they are sinners. Jesus Christ is the sole expression of the glory. The Word became flesh and we beheld His glory. So when Jesus came as the Word expressed in flesh, that's when the glory of God was revealed the first time. The first man was off the earth and he was natural. Adam was not spiritual. Come on, we've got many preachers in the house. You can raise your hand anytime if you want to correct me. Make sure you got the scripture when you want to correct me. And if you can't correct me out of the scripture, let's repent and turn back to the Word of God. Was not spiritual, he was natural. 1 Corinthians 15, the first man was of the earth, earthy, a natural man. When God breathed into Adam, Adam stood up a living soul, not a living spirit. That's why his emotions controlled him when his wife offered him the fruit of the wrong tree. Is it too much? How do you like Prophet Angel? I'll try my best. I'm anointed to teach under a prophetic anointing. That means to give direction to the church. And say, this is the way. You're taking the wrong road. Okay? He's the sole expression. Okay. Where do we go? Okay. Verse 5. For to which of the angels did God ever say, you are my son? Today have I begotten you. And again, I will be to my father, you will be to me a son. Verse 8. But of the son he says to him, your throne, O God, is forever and ever. Verse 13, besides, to which of the angels has he ever said, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies a stool of your foot? Okay? Okay. Just look this way and look holy. Where are you from? With the Greek. Huh? The original Greek died. His name was Zorba. Okay. Never did God at any time ever said to any angel, you are my son. God never called angels sons. Why? The next verse says, they are all ministering spirits sent out to minister to those who are to be heirs of salvation. But of the son, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool or the stool of your feet. Okay. Have we been raised together with Christ? Ephesians 2 verse 4 through 8. Okay. You were dead in your trespasses and sins. He has forgiven you, raised you up together and seated you together in Christ in heavenly places. So if we are raised together and he said to the Son, sit. And by the Spirit and by faith, we are all sons of God. 1 John 3 verse 1. I mean, look what love the Father has for us, that we can be called the sons of God. John 1 verse 12, as many as received him, unto them gave he the power to become the sons of God. So if we are sons, we are seated together with Christ in heavenly place at the right hand. So he says to the Son, sit till your enemies be made your footstool. In other words, when Christ appears, Colossians 3 verse 4, when Christ shall appear, we shall also appear with him in glory. Okay, so he came and brought the glory. He didn't bring the glory back. He was the first one to bring the glory. Now we are heirs of God, joint heirs with Jesus Christ, seated together in heavenly places. Now we have the glory. As we behold in this mirror the image of Christ, we are changed from the glory of the old to the glory of the new. So we get the glory. And what is happening now? Now we seated till all our enemies be made our footstool. So Christ is not appearing till the enemies be made the footstool. What is the last enemy? So we're waiting for the appearance of Christ. How will he appear? We know that the whole creation groans and is in earnest expectation. Listen. Since all this is true, we ought to pay much closer attention than ever to the truths that we have heard, lest in any way we drift past them and slip away. Somebody need to say, oh God, help. Since all this is true, let us pay much closer attention to the truth that we heard, lest in any way they're gonna just slip by us. I don't know about you, but I don't want the truth of this word to slip by me and sit in the 1946 revival, the 1906 revival, the 1898 revival, the 1747 revival. I want to get what they have, and I want to add it all, the former and the latter rain in 1 month. I want to have everything that they have, but I want to have fresh revelation from the Word of God. What is God saying? On the 13th day of the second month of the year 2013 of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, God is saying, church, it's time to realize why Christ loved you. He died so that you might not perish, but have everlasting life. Listen. Verse 5. For it was not to angels that God subjected the habitable world. Yes. Hey. Yes. It was not to angels that God subjected the habitable world to the future, but of man. Huh? Where can we go? Verse 8. For you have put everything in subjection under his feet. Now in putting everything in subjection to man, I hope somebody can hear. Yes. He left nothing outside of man's control. But at present, now this was written 2,000 years ago. At present, we do not yet see.
Okay.
Anybody English? We do not yet see all things subject to man, but we are able to see Jesus.
Yes.
Okay, here it comes. Who was made for a little while lower than the angels, crowned with glory and honor because of his having suffered death, in order that by the grace of God he might experience death for every individual person. No, you didn't hear. I'm standing in the front row where all the holy preachers are sitting in holy array. but we haven't heard. Jesus Christ suffered so that he might experience death for every man. So if he experienced death for you, you don't have to experience death yourself. If the last enemy is death, and we must conquer him, and Christ already defeated him, then it means we need to tap somewhere into the glory because of the love of God and understand that there need to be something different. Everything we see in so-called revivals have been seen already.
Yes.
So what must happen that will shake this world to such an extent that everybody will take notice? I hope somebody has got a memory. But Job, God speaks to Job in chapter 33, verse 25. He says, if I can find one amongst a thousand, a ransom that will show unto man the righteousness, then his flesh will be fresher than a child, and he will return to the days of his youth. Did God find a ransom? Did God now show unto man that you are now the righteousness of God in Christ? Then it means your youth must return. I don't know, but the nations are as a drop in the bucket. He sits upon the circle of the earth. People are as grasshoppers in front of him. The young men even stumble and fall, but they that wait upon the Lord will renew their strength. Brother, it's one thing to preach it, but it's another thing to experience it and preach it at the same time. It's one thing to speak about death. It's another thing to die and then speak about death. Tomorrow morning, we're going to speak on the city of perfection a little bit. It's going to be great. It's going to be awesome. But Matthew chapter 5 verse 40 says, you are the light of the world. You are a city that is set on a hill that cannot be hidden. So 2 years ago, I haven't even come to what I'm thinking, but it's all right. So I've been preaching this city now for nearly 30 years, that we are the city, we are the light, you know, kingdom on earth as it is in heaven, stuff like it. So, New Year's Eve 2011, I'm lying in hospital. I think I mentioned it here sometime, not here, but in this church a while ago. And I'm getting blood transfusions. My blood's just eaten up. Doctors can't know cancer. I'm dying. 86 blood transfusions in 5 months. Okay, so don't, well, I had it, not you. So thank God I don't have it right now. Okay, so I'm getting blood in the one arm. And the other arm here, I've got an intravenous drip with cortisone and stuff that they put in my body. It's 8 o'clock, 31st of December. We've got a meeting 10 o'clock till 12 o'clock. I say to the doctor, the oncologist come and said, would you please take the blood out and the drip out? I'm preaching in 2 hours. She said, you cannot go out of this hospital, not now, not tomorrow. You are dying, your blood is so low. If you come amongst people, you'll just die because of the atmosphere of people, because your platelets and everything's so low. No joke.
Yeah.
I said, doctor, you take the drip out, you take the blood out, or I'll take it out myself. No joke. They made a short drip for those who were here, 2011. I came in church with the short drips, and I showed it to the people. I said, 12 o'clock tonight, I must go back to hospital. Okay?
Yeah.
So I'm waiting for the doctor to come take it out. And as I'm waiting, I'm drifting into a little bit of a sleep. and I'm caught up. Caught up. So here comes these two angels, maybe four, maybe six, I don't know. White, glistering white wings. And they said, we've come to take you to that city. And here we travel. You know, like all the stories you've heard of the people that had near-death experience. So we travel at the speed of light. And there in the distance is the bright light of that city. And we're getting closer with a very great speed. And the angels started speaking to us. He said, you have preached the people wrong. You have taught them wrong doctrines. You said you're the city. Look, there's the city. See, here we are, the angels that's coming to fetch you, like you've heard all the old people say. I thought, but God, something's wrong. I mean, either the word is wrong or the word is right. But I never read of angels, you know, coming to take you away to a city. You know, I know they make, you know, their own ideas. And as we're approaching the city, I felt like it's so much easier now to just die. So I felt maybe I should just die. I mean, here's the city. Why must I fight? And as I was just going, oh, thank you, Jesus, at last, oh, the city. I looked down and the angels had claws under their white raiment. Claws. Yeah. Like a vulture. And God spoke and he said, the devil comes as an angel of light. And his angels will come as angels of light. And I looked and I said, we are the city. And the city exploded like a volcano with that gray ash. And these things became the demons they were. And God spoke. He said, go tell my people, you are the city. You can believe it because it is the word. But we need to preach. Verse 10. Yes. For it was an act worthy of God and fitting to the divine nature that he, for whose sake and by whom all things have their existence, in bringing many sons into glory, should make the pioneer of their salvation perfect. It's all right. For both he who sanctifies and those who are sanctified all have one Father. For this reason, he's not ashamed to call them brethren. Yeah. Verse 14. Since therefore these children share in flesh and blood in the physical nature of human beings, he himself in a similar manner partook of the same nature, that by going through death he might bring to naught and make of no effect him who had the power over death, that is the devil, and also that he might deliver and completely set free all those who through fear of death were held in bondage. It's a struggle now for the people that want to die. Why is it a struggle? Because 1 Timothy 6 verse 12 says, fight the good fight of faith, laying hold on eternal life. What do you fight for if you want to die? Nothing. You close your eyes and you're dead. It's no fight. Just look at me. Let's just be natural for a while. Just come out of the spirit, natural. You go to the hospital and you go to the sick people lying in ICU. They're fighting with everything in them to live. Why don't they just die? Because somewhere in them there's a crying out to be the manifested sons of God, which is the Christ life, which is indestructible, incorruptible, immortal life. If death was the ultimate experience, Why don't we just all die when we get saved? Why do we have this struggle? The devil has been lying to the church. I try hard. I heard there's somebody else that say the same. What can we do? Yes. Let's just do chapter 6, verse 1. I'm just paging. I don't know what to do. I start off with the wrong message. What is this book? A book of death or a book of life? Did Jesus come to give you a death experience or a life experience? I'm just asking. If Jesus conquered him who had power over the death, the devil, why do we want to die then? Then we're fighting against what Jesus paid the price for. It's going to be a struggle after tonight for some preachers. If you die tonight, where will you spend eternity? I ask it over and over. Can some preacher please give me the scripture for the gospel invitation of evangelists or preachers or pastors or prophets or apostles? If you die tonight, where will you spend eternity? Why do we frighten people with the thing that Jesus came to set us free from? You don't have to shout now. But if he, through death, delivered us from the bondage of fear of death, that doesn't mean you don't fear death now. Wait, brother, till death knocks on your door and see if you fear him or not. Okay, I'll repeat. Wait till death knock on your door, then you see if you want to die or not. Brother, when you feel life is draining out of your being, you will know without a shadow of doubt that Jesus did not come to take you away. He came to bring you life. He's not coming to take us away. He's coming back to be revealed in his church and in his people. When Christ is revealed, we shall be revealed with him in glory. Maybe I should just leave the Bible and just preach. But it's all right. Verse 6, chapter 6, verse 1. Therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ, let us go on to perfection. Yes, I'm doing it. Preaching it. Teaching it. What are you talking about? Are you going to teach immortality tonight? No, I'm just talking about love. God so loved that he gave that we should not perish but have everlasting life. Scriptures. Says Jesus. Search the scriptures. What would happen if we present the gospel of life and not a gospel of death? What will happen if we teach people, if you want to live, make Jesus Lord of your life. And not if you die. If the snake bites you, you die. Not just to die, to die. Jesus died not to bring you a better death. Jesus died to bring you life. Now, in religion, you can argue, but when it comes to the word, who are you going to argue against? Against who are you going to argue? Okay, we are in 1 Corinthians 13. Maybe I shouldn't read it. Maybe I should just... Okay, just look at this way. We all know 1 Corinthians 13. If I can speak in tongues of men and angels and I have not love, sounding brass, things, if I have all prophetic gifts and have the faith to move mountains and have not love, I am nothing. If I love is patient, love is gentle, love is kind, love doesn't seek his own things, love is not easily revoked. You know, we know it. Do I have to read it? Okay. We prophesy in part, we have, what is it all saying? Knowledge is fragmentary, prophecy is in part, incomplete and imperfect. But when the perfect is come, verse 10. Seems like I lost a lot of you. But when that which is perfect is come, that which is in part will be done away with. For the people that are hurt, we're bringing ointment to your wounds in a minute. Jesus, your word. Okay, so let us go on to perfection. If 1 Corinthians 13 says, love is perfection. Now by the faith, hope, love, the greatest is love. Go back to chapter 12, verse 31. Desire the spiritual gifts, but I show you even a more excellent way. In other words, it's all right to seek the gifts, but there is something better. Wait, don't judge. You haven't got the authority to judge me. Neither the power, neither the ability. And I'll prove it to you 1 minute. Desire the gifts, but I will show you something better. Love. So we can speak in tongues. We can prophesy. We can have a word of wisdom. We can have a word of knowledge. It's all in part. When that which is perfect is come, that which is in part, word of knowledge, word of wisdom, fragmentary prophecies, speaking in tongues, will be done away with. Does that mean we're not going to prophesy, we're not going to speak in tongues, we're not going to... No, listen. The word, not my religious ideas, the word. When that which is perfect is come, that which is in part will be done. Here comes our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Out of the desert, filled with the Spirit, driven into the desert by the Holy Spirit, tempted 40 days, he comes back. He goes to the synagogue, find the place in the scroll where it is written, Isaiah 60 and 61. He starts reading. The Spirit, listen, there's a lot of strangers. The Spirit of the Lord, I see I've lost some attention today. The Spirit is all right. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. Then he goes on, broken hearts, wounds, eyes, all that stuff. Spirit, this day is this scripture, not yesterday, this day. This scripture is fulfilled in your ears. Then he sat down, gave the scroll to the guy that was attending the synagogue. Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Luke chapter 4 verse 18. John 3 verse 34. Take note of the scriptures. John 3:34. He that God sent speaks the word of God because God has not given him the spirit with measure. Okay? Some people are not listening. They switch off when they heard the impart stuff. Jesus didn't have a gift of the Spirit. He had the Spirit. Not with measure, without measure. John 3:34. The Spirit without, everybody say it if you dare say it. The Spirit without me. In other words, Jesus was not bound to a gift of a word of wisdom. Jesus was not bound with a gift of a word of knowledge. Jesus was not bound with a gift of prophecy. Jesus came as a prophet. Jesus came with the Spirit. Okay. Please, in Jesus' name, don't let me miss you. Jesus, Isaiah chapter 11, when he comes, the branch man, the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him. The Spirit of wisdom, the Spirit of counsel, the Spirit of might. Not a gift of a word of wisdom, not a gift of a word of knowledge. The Spirit of wisdom, the Spirit of knowledge. So when that which is perfect is come, in other words, when I'm totally filled with the love of God, I don't prophesy, I'm a prophet. I don't have a word of wisdom, I have wisdom. I don't have a word of knowledge, I have knowledge. I don't minister in part, I minister the Spirit without measure. Okay, when he ascended, Ephesians chapter 4 verse 8, what is it that the first descended into the lower parts of the earth? When he ascended, he gave gifts unto man, apostolic, prophetic, evangelistic, pastoral, and teaching, to perfect the saints for the full equipping of ministry, verse 13. Till we all arrive at really mature manhood, the very perfect standard of Christ's own perfection. Nothing less than the standard height of Christ. So why do we have the giftings? Not the gifts of the Holy Spirit. The gifts of apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers to equip the saints till we all come to perfection. The stature of the perfection of Christ himself, the manifested sons of God. You are the Christ, the sons of the living God. Scripture. When the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord shall raise up a stand against him. Have you read the context? In Isaiah 59, it said, he looked around and he saw that there was no intercessor. So his own arm amplified brackets, the Spirit without measure. I'll try it again. He looked around and saw that there was no intercessor. So his own right arm, right hand, brackets, amplified Bible, amplified Bible, the Spirit without measure came to his aid. So then it says, because of Messiah's intervention, there shall come a flood at the breath of the Almighty God, like mighty waters. When the enemy comes in, there's a flood that's going to just push him out of the way. What a law! is now thirsty, let him come to me. And as the scripture says, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. The love of God has been shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Spirit given to us. The more I'm filled, the more the river flow. The more the river flow, the more the Spirit comes without measure, pushing every enemy out of the way and conquering the last enemy, death.
Maha shiketo kurabahadete.
What's the time? Early. You like it? You're dumb if you don't take the message of life. Yes, the word. John chapter 11. What are you preaching? The word. The word. You know what? In 2006, the year before we started building our new church, we had a lot of pastors from Singapore and South Korea and stuff in the old church, and I started touching on life. And I remember the guy sitting in the front, Pastor Tay Ching Ki, great church in Singapore. And I said to him, you know what, brother, when the message of life comes, it's so easy to heal the sick. Because if you want to heal the sick, you always got to get rid of the sickness. But when you minister life, it just gets rid of all the sicknesses. You can read thick books like this on topics. I see the people sitting reading books, books and books and books on different topics. Why don't you read this book? I've got thicker books than this on my shelf on different topics. When I studied electronics, you should see the books that I studied. Thick books like this. And we had to study it. And you know what? We memorized it. We memorized the equations. When I did physics on the fourth level, you know, university level, you know, physics, I loved physics. Huh? I loved Newton and all those guys and Einstein. He said, if I can just get God's thoughts, the rest is details. But we had to memorize it. Why don't we just memorize the scriptures? The devil has lied to the church. He said, you can't memorize. Then you know what the devil says? You can't concentrate longer than 20 minutes, but you can sit in a movie for 3 hours, and after the movie, you can tell the whole movie to everybody. You can read a magazine and you can tell all your friends what you read in the magazine. But you say, oh man, you know, somewhere in the Bible, somewhere there's something that says something like this. Say out loud, I will not be lied to any longer. I can memorize the word. I can know the word. And I can understand the word. We are in John chapter 11. We are in John chapter 11. Who's enjoying this? Okay. Come on, say amen now. Say amen now. Amen now. Just for the old Afrikaans people. My brother, my sister, ek sal nou elke amen vat wat ek in hierdie huis kan kry. Die Here Jesus is vanaand in hierdie plek en ek sal nou elke amen vat wat ek kan kry. You donkeys will not understand it because you scream in the mic. What is he saying? He's blowing the speakers up. The English people, my God, tonight as we come together, what we're actually saying is, can I have an amen? Okay, Jesus is now at Lazarus's tomb. I'm just irritating your religious igniter. Okay. Jesus is now at Lazarus's tomb. Verse 36. Remember what we're talking about. Then said the Jews, behold how he loved him. Meditate. Amen. Yeah, it's two amens is good. Amen. Hmm? Oh. Oh. Hmm. It's too much now. Hey. They didn't say, what awesome gifting, anointing. He said, look how he loved him. Yeah. 38, Jesus therefore again groaning in himself. Okay, we know the groanings of creation. I don't have to talk about that. It's very quiet now. Just look this way. Let me try and get the crowd back. In Romans chapter 8, from verse 26 to verse 30, he says, we do not rightly know what to pray for, but the Holy Spirit comes to our aid with groanings that's too deep for utterance. Hmm? But he that searches the heart knows what is the meaning of the Spirit, therefore he can intercede accordingly. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God. That which the Holy Spirit is interceding for with groanings. Huh? He says, for those whom he did foreknew, we also did predestinate. And those who he predestinated, he also loved. Those he loved, you know. To do what? To be conformed to the image of his son. Yes. Amens are getting weaker. Are you tired? No. Are you hearing? Yes. So what is the groanings for? To be conformed to the image of the son. What is the image of the Son? The express image of the glory of the Father. The outradiance of the divine. The express image of God himself. If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. Father, I pray that they will be one, even as I and you are one, that I will be in them and they in us and we in them, that the world can know that you have sent me. The glory that you have given me, I have given them, that the world may know that you have sent me. Equality with Christ. He didn't even spare the throne. He even shared the throne with you. Hmm? Yeah. Okay, verse 39. Jesus said, take away the stone. Hmm? You know the story. Lord, he stinks. Verse 40. Jesus said, said I not unto you, if you would believe, you'd see the glory of God. Verse 43, Lazarus come forth. Back to 24. Martha saith unto him, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Stop. Stop. Look this way. Who believes in the resurrection of the dead? Treasures. They believed in it right through the Bible. It's not something new. Lord, I know in the resurrection he shall rise again. Verse 25. Here's the thing that set me going 31 years ago. I am the resurrection and the life. Listen, he that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. 26, and whosoever live and believe in me shall never die. Do you believe this? Shout. I am prophesying God is raising up a generation right now that'll start saying, I believe, I believe, I believe. Those that believe and die shall live again. But those that live and believe shall never die. Do you believe this? We're still shorting about 85 people. Those that believe and die shall live again. Those that believe and die. But those that live and believe shall never die. Do What awesome price did he pay? Why did he cry out, it is finished, if it was not finished? Maybe you're not getting the full intent of what I'm trying to say here tonight. But I'm not trying to say anything. Up till now, I've just been quoting scriptures and reading a few. Listen, listen, listen. When I was challenged on this message, bless all you guys. Bless all you guys giving. Listen, when I was challenged, and by nobody but by my wife, she should have been here now, Annalise. When she challenged me on this message years ago and said, this stuff you're preaching, why isn't it that people didn't believe it 50 years ago? Why is it that now you must bring this new revelation? I said, whoa, 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 whoa. Wait. It's been there 2,000 years. But listen. Listen. Listen, especially if you're a preacher. Listen. Romans chapter 10 says, from verse 4, Christ is the end of the law to all that believe. Full stop. Okay? Then Moses described the righteousness which is the law like this, the man that lived thereby, and then you know the righteousness which is of faith. But the righteousness which is of faith speaks. Listen, it says, do not say who shall ascend into the heavens to bring Christ back. Or who shall go down to the abyss to bring Christ up? But what does it say? The word is near you, in your heart and in your mouth, to speak it. Listen, whoa, you can clap now. Paul is quoting from Deuteronomy chapter 30. This commandment that I give you this day is not difficult. It's not across the sea that you should say, who should go over the sea to bring it to us? Neither is it in the depths of the earth that you should say, who should bring it up to us? But the word is near you, even in your heart and your mind. This is the word of life. Deuteronomy 30, that I bring you today. I'm quoting on. So I bring to you today, no, blessing and cursing, good and evil, life and death. The end of the chapter. Choose life that you may live, you and your seed. Right, wait. Years later, in Romans, Paul is still quoting the same scripture. In other words, they have still not chosen. Whoa. So Paul goes on. You can follow me if I'm wrong. Like I said, put up your hand, stop me anytime, say, Kubis, what about this, what about that? If I quote wrong. If I quote right, I may miss a word of that because I'm just interpreting. Okay, listen. You're all with me. We're still in Romans 10. Okay? So the word is near you in your heart and in your mouth to speak it. But what does it say? Listen to this. How shall they believe? You must listen carefully. How shall they believe if they do not hear? How shall they hear if it's not preached? How shall they preach if they not send? As it is said, how beautiful are the feet of him that brings good tidings. So then, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word. But well did Isaiah say, they have not all believed. Going back to Hebrews chapter 4 verse 2. They did not enter because they did not believe, because faith was not mixed with, or the words was not mixed with faith. Okay, what did you say just now, Kubis? It was not yet believed because it was not heard. It was not heard because it was not preached. Repeat, people did not believe eternal life because they did not hear eternal life. People did not hear eternal life because people did not preach eternal life. People did not preach eternal life because they were not sent to preach it. Now, I've prophesied 2006, and I said, in 5 years from now, which happened to be 2 years ago, more and more people will preach it, more and more will hear it, then more and more will believe it. The more that will believe it, the more will speak it. The more that will speak it, the more will hear it. Luckily, you can get all our DVDs. And I said by 2012, the rapture people will once again be proven wrong because nothing will happen to the church. The biggest legalistic doctrine on earth that takes you right back to the law is the rapture, because you gotta be super holy to be part of it. If you miss somewhere, you're gonna miss the rapture. That is the biggest law trash on the face of the earth. Jesus a coward to come and steal you away? Okay, forget that. I can't speak on the rapture. There's a series of tape, Rapture True or False. You can make a monkey puzzle and just draw a cross where it says false. Okay.
Right.
A moment of silence. For all the false doctrines that are dying now. You see, we speak stuff because we heard it. Because we heard it, we believed it. But when the word comes as the authority, that which is not God must fall away. Kubis, what am I going to preach after tonight? Truth. But Kubis, I've been teaching rapture now for 15 years in my church. Tell them you were wrong. Tell them you're going to stay right here and take over. Hebrews chapter 2, we do not yet see everything under man's control, but we are able to see Jesus. Creation is waiting for you not to run away, to take over. Okay, let's just throw one scripture in. I want to finish with John chapter 3. But listen, I'll just throw this one in. But you've got to listen. Paul writes to Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 1 verse 10. He says, Jesus Christ came to bring to light through the gospel life and immortality. Yes. Romans chapter 2 verse 7. To those who through diligent persistence seek glory, honor, and immortality, they shall reap eternal life. Okay, here's the scripture. But you must listen. Quibus, but it is appointed unto man once to die. And after that, the judgment. Oh, where is that scripture, Corbis? Can anybody help me? Where is that scripture? Okay, Hebrews 9, verse 27. Can somebody read verse 25, 6, and 7 for us? Yes. Read it. Where you sit, I'm not going to say anything. You read it. And tell me where it says it's appointed unto you once to die. Once at the end of the world, which world? The Judaistic law world. Once in the end of that world, he came with a sacrifice of his own blood to put away our sins. For it is appointed unto man once to die. He suffered once. Okay, you didn't hear that. You're not even interested in hearing it. If it wasn't a finished work, he had to suffer again and again. He did it once, and after that came the judgment. God poured out the judgment on Jesus Christ. Therefore, for us, oh man, there is now no condemnation, no judgment, no accusation. For those that are interested, Tony, for those that are still interested, I'll read and then I'll tell you where it's written. Bless you, great. Listen, Saul, no, I mustn't say where it is. Listen. You shall arise and have mercy upon Zion. Listen to the Amplified. For it is time to have compassion for her. The set time has come, the moment designated. There's a designated moment for Zion. Listen. When the Lord shall build up Zion, he shall appear in his glory. When Christ shall appear, we shall also appear with him in glory. Are you ready? Listen to the next verse. He will regard the prayer of the destitute and not despise their prayer. Let this be recorded. For loss of interest, I'll just read it fast. Let this be recorded for the generation yet unborn, that the people yet to be created shall. Okay, for those that are interested, I'll read it slowly. Let this, what I'm reading now, that there's a designated moment. Let this be recorded for the generation that is yet unborn. Listen to the rest. So that a people yet to be created shall praise the Lord. For he looked down from the height of his sanctuary, from heaven that the Lord looked to the earth, to hear the groaning of the prisoners. I'm reading. To lose their appointment with death. Psalm 102. The designated moment to favor Zion is when God will hear the groaning. The whole creation is groaning and waiting for the man of it to lose their appointment with death. For the last enemy to be conquered is death. It was appointed for Christ to die. Why are you going to die? For this reason came I into this world, to die. Peter rebuked him. Jesus said, get behind me, Satan. This is why I came. You can clap now if you want to. Just the word. I love the gift of the prophet Hubert Angel and his brother next to him, son. I'm a different prophet. I bring the word and give you direction and say, this is the way. Walk ye therein. Kubas, do you prophesy? I've been prophesying for an hour now. Okay. What did you prophesy? Or didn't you hear? Tell me you don't know when to stop. Hmm?
preaching. I'm doing my best. France, hurry up. Relax. If you want to die, die. Nobody will stop you. Die. Full stop. If you don't want life, nobody will hinder you. There's hospitals you can go to, you can die. Then all that stuff on the crucifix was for no avail. But Kubis, why didn't it happen 50 years ago? Because of the designated moment. Psalm 102, verse 13. There's a designated moment in time when people will start preaching it so that people will start believing it. When the appointment with death will be canceled. And life will enter, and the sons of God will stand up and be revealed as the Christ, and Christ will be revealed in his church, and we will be revealed with him. Lazarus, come forth. Listen. Here's a good one. Romans 6:23. I'm talking love. The wages of sin. Oh, is it? What's the rest of the verse? So why don't we preach the next portion? The wages of sin is death, my brother. You can play with sin, but be sure you're gonna die. What about the gift of God is eternal life? Romans 8 verse 3, the law of the spirit of life which is in Christ Jesus has made us free from the law of sin. Brother, Christ came to set you free from sin. What about the rest of the scripture and death? Is there? There, in your Bible. In the Bible. Set you free from sin and death. Timing. Paul says to 2 Timothy, to Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 1, he says, I am a preacher of this, verse 10, 11, and 12. He says, and I'm not ashamed of it, though I will not get it. Yeah. So I'm preaching it, but I know I'm not getting it. Because the time. Why would it be the right time? Maurice Sorello said years ago, all truths are parallel. Have you ever gone into a chemist, a pharmacy, a health shop, and seen the product that you will see today? Anti-wrinkle, anti-aging, hair grow. Yeah. Oh, no. You don't understand. People look at me like... That's fine. Why is everybody anti-aging? You go into my office right now, there's a box lying there. You can go there. There's two Time magazines. Time. T-I-M-E. Time magazine. Immortality in reach.
Yeah.
Scientists, not one scripture. It is proven that just because of water, not even food, people will now in the next few years reach the age of 120. But in the next 40 to 50 years, people's lifespan will go up to 500 if they just eat right. Nothing to do with the word, just eating and drinking right. How much more if we take the word and add it? Now remember 1 Corinthians 15, as we bore the image of the earthy, we shall also bear the image of the heavenly. This corruption must put on incorruption. This mortal must put on immortality. Somebody must preach it.
Yeah, preach it, preach it.
You go out now tonight and throw stones. That's a proof I'm a prophet. Because Jesus said they stoned the prophets. They still do it today. What did the prophets do? Can anybody tell me? They just brought the word of God to the people. And said, this is what God says in his word. Elijah, Elijah, Malachi. So what are we doing as prophets? Bringing you back to the word. This is what the word says. What did they do to the prophets? They stoned them. You know what Jesus said? If they come now, they'll stone them again. Why? Because religion, Mark 7:30. You make the word of God of no effect because of your traditions. I got to close, man. I wanted to do John 3, the whole thing. No, I want to close by 10. Why? Because I'm preaching tomorrow at the pool. Now, listen. 4 months ago, I still couldn't walk. Thank you, Jesus, for all the prayers and all the words. Here we are tonight preaching the word of God. Just one more thought on the love of God. Just one more thought on the love of God. In this life thing. Jesus is born. Herod kills the babies. Angel appeared to Joseph. Take the mother and the child, flee to Egypt. To fulfill the Psalms, I have brought my son out of Egypt. So here goes Jesus into Egypt. To do what? To fulfill Revelation 12. Yes. The man child fled into the wilderness. Okay? Yeah. Fulfilled at the birth of Jesus. So Satan was cast out at the birth. He was destroyed at the crucifixion. And now the church need to enforce what Christ has done. Listen, we're not going there. So why would Jesus flee? Or why would Joseph flee with a baby if it wasn't possible to kill him? Okay, does my question make sense? Herod gave a command to kill all the babies under two. If it was not possible to kill Jesus, why did they have to flee? In other words, the baby could have been killed. Right? Now Jesus is baptized with the Holy Ghost. Spirit of the Lord is upon me. But he's already born by the Spirit through Mary. The Spirit of God shall come upon you. The power of the Most High shall overshadow you. And the holy thing that shall be born of you shall be called the Son of God. Okay, so Christ is already born of the Spirit. Yet he could be killed, although he was born of the Spirit. Now the Spirit comes upon him. And twice it says they wanted to kill him, but he just walked through them. He became indestructible, undiable. Quickly, John 10, listen, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd laid down his life for his friend. Listen closely. No man can take my life from me. I lay it down of myself and I lift it up again by myself. Nobody could kill him. Philippians 2, he had to become obedient to death. He had to say, you can't kill me, so I'll have to become obedient. Death, here I am. I mean, all the blood he lost, nobody could stay alive. Yeah. All the beatings, nobody could stay alive. Yes. So supernaturally, he's just going on and on and on. They beat him, he carries the cross, they nail him, they put him on the cross. Nobody can take my life. I have to lay it down. What made him indestructible? He said he was sealed with the Holy Spirit. John chapter 6. God sealed him with the Holy Spirit. So he hangs on the cross. They can't kill him. Can't kill him. Can't kill him. Because he's sealed with the Holy Ghost. Can't kill him. Sealed with the Holy Ghost. For those that are still paying attention. John chapter 19, verse 30. And Jesus gave up the ghost. No man can take it. I have to lay it down. I have to give up life. So Jesus gave up the ghost. Okay? If the same spirit that raised up Christ from the dead dwell in you, the same spirit that raised up Jesus shall also quicken your mortal bodies. We quote it so easily, but if the Spirit quicken my mortal body, quicken means make alive. What then happens to my mortal body? It becomes immortal. Thank you, my darling. Give Opa a hug. Katie? Don't give up, God. Our authority is the Word of God. Our foundation is the Word of God. Church of Jesus Christ, we have a message to bring to this world, a message of life. The world around us is in desperation. They're sick. They are dying. We need to bring them life. Good news. Christ died so that you can live. The designated moment. The favorable time to favor Zion, the designated moment, has come. To hear the groaning of the prisoners in Zion, to lose their appointment with death. How would you like to know your appointment with death is cancelled? But right now, Father, I pray for my brothers and sisters, for the immeasurable Spirit of the living God. Something that this world has not yet seen, not yet heard, never came up in the heart of man. Because we love you, because you love us, you died for us so that we can live again. God, this night, so much truth just came out. Help us to absorb it, to listen carefully, not to criticize before we checked it out, not to judge, but to go to the scriptures and see what God has to say. I pray that this night life will break through, that death will be canceled for every person standing, for all families and every person related to people here tonight, that all sickness. death and destruction, corruption disappear, and that life come in Jesus' name.